So, what we have seen up to now is that norm-continuous groups correspond to bounded self-adjoint operators. So that's the conclusion from these statements, which we proved that bounded self-adjoint operators correspond via going over to ut, which is e to the I t a. So they correspond to norm-continuous. Continuous unitary groups UT. Yeah, but actually norm continuous unitary groups are not very realistic from a physical point of view, and also the corresponding generator, which is a bounded generator, is also not very realistic as a Hamiltonian. So the generators in physics correspond to the Hamiltonians, and usually Hamiltonians are unbounded. Or I mean, there are many situations where they are unbounded. So we really have to extend the theory to capture maybe the most interesting physical systems. So this setting here is nice. Also mathematically nice, but it is somehow too restrictive. And this setting, for this setting, we wouldn't need unbounded operators. But yeah, we have to go further. So norm continuous time evolutions or bounded Hamiltonians are not realistic in many situations. So one needs an extension, and this is a generalization to unbounded operators. Okay, and first we should think about what does this mean on the side of the unitary groups. So there we should have the norm continuity should also be weakened to something. And probably it's clear what this should be, but let me just collect this in the next theorem, which is again somehow the easy direction. Namely, now we start from here, where at least we know what we want. We want namely to have a generator which is still self-adjoint, but we allow it to be unbounded. Okay, and then we see what we get here. And this is again easy direction, in particular if we have the functional calculus, because then we can define this without problem, and we can also get the properties from our functional calculus. So this is a theorem, so I'm going to write it down, but not proving it, but so this we can do as an exercise. And this is not so hard given everything we know about functional calculus. So we start from t, so this should be an unbounded. Unbounded means possibly unbounded self-adjoint operator on some Hilbert space, and we define now this exponential of it, and I mean the definition as a power series is now not so clear anymore whether this makes sense, but we can in any case use our functional calculus. So we define ut as e to the it times t for all t and r. And we do this via functional calculus because then it's defined in any case. So via functional calculus, and maybe let me recall. So this means we are given our operator, so we find its resolution of identity. So we know that we can write t as an integral over the function lambda with respect to a resolution of identity, which depends on t and is uniquely determined by t. And if I have this resolution of identity, I can integrate arbitrary measurable functions, and this gives me the corresponding function of t. So this means here I'm taking, for the function f, I'm taking e to the it lambda, and this means I can now define the u of t via functional calculus as integrating e to the it lambda with respect to this spectral resolution of my operator t. Good, so this is well defined, and then I can check what properties do I have. And of course I have again the properties of my unitary group. This is just the algebraic things which follow from the functional calculus very easily. So then we have, so first of all, the u's are unitary again, so all of them are unitary. So ut is unitary for each real t. Then at zero, I get the identity. I have, of course, this semigroup property. So ut times us is ut plus s for all real s and t. And now, of course, the crucial point is what happens with the continuity. So we cannot be as continuous in this in a strong sense as before for bounded operators, but we have a weaker form of continuity, and of course this is the continuity which fits very nicely with unbounded operators. Namely, we cannot talk about the operator norm anymore. So we don't have uniform estimates what happens if I apply my operator to any vector in a Hilbert space, but I can look at least for each vector in a Hilbert space, at least in a domain, I can look what happens to it. And so that's the kind of pointwise convergence, or the strong convergence for my operators. And that's what happens here. So namely, I have that the u of t converge again to the identity, but not in the norm, but in the strong topology, which means if I apply it to an operator, then it has this convergence. So the limit t going to zero of ut, but now applied to a vector, this always converges to u0 applied to the vector, but this is of course just the identity on the vector, which is just the vector itself. That this guy here goes to zero. And this is true for any vector in my Hilbert space. But I don't have a uniform estimate about the speed of convergence, which is independent of my vector. So it goes to zero, but the speed, how fast it goes to zero, can depend on x. So that's like, that's a strong operator topology. So that's like for functions, the operator norm is the uniform norm, and this norm here is like the pointwise norm. So I have to check it for each argument, but I don't have uniform estimates. And the proof of this, we will do it as an exercise. I mean, 1, 2, 3 should be more or less clear, and maybe about 4 one should think a bit just to make sure that this is really the appropriate and also the right notion what happens here. So I leave this as an exercise. But this is not too hard. But this now shows what we should expect and hope for when we go the other direction. So namely, we wanted to weaken this here to a situation of unbounded operators. And of course here we can say here we have unbounded operators, then we can go this direction. This is this here. And now we see instead of norm continuity, we get this strong continuity. And now, of course, we expect that we should also have a theorem in the other direction if we start here from strongly continuous groups. And that's then exactly the theorem of Stone. But maybe let me give a name, or let me just call this strongly continuous unitary group, just to have a name, and so that I don't have to repeat those properties again when I'm writing down the theorem of Stone. So maybe just as a definition, and if I have a collection of UTs which satisfy the properties 1 to 4 in this theorem, then I call it a strongly continuous unitary group. So those guys with the properties 1 to 4, such a thing is called a strongly. And the main point here is to put the strongly there in contrast to the norm continuous semigroup. So it's a strongly continuous unitary group, and maybe we could also make it more specific because it's a one parameter. We just have one parameter there, but that's the only thing we consider here. So I'm not looking on other groups. So we just call it a strongly continuous unitary group. And then the theorem of Stone will tell us that we should have it also the other way around. And maybe let me write it down. So that's now really the theorem of Stone. I mean, you can say it's this one-to-one correspondence, but the real action happens in this direction here. So namely, if I'm starting from a strongly continuous unitary group, then I'm getting a generator, which is self-adjoint, but in general will be unbounded. So let UT, T in R, be strongly continuous unitary group, and then I'm claiming that there exists a generator, then there exists a generator, and again this is of course uniquely determined, uniquely determined generator, and this is in general an unbounded but still self-adjoint, and now self-adjoint really means self-adjoint and not symmetric, so an unbounded self-adjoint operator T such that the relation between the UT and this generator is given by this form, by this relation which you always have, this exponentiation, so ET, UT is E to the IT times my generator. Okay, and now, now we have to prove this.